Hello, and welcome to I Heart Cooking. I'm registered dietitian Jennifer Stachler.
And I'm Chef Dugan Wetzel.
We are both from Reid Health. Today's program is brought to you by Reid Health Community Benefits, RPNL, and WCTV. Today on I Heart Cooking, we're learning about different seafood recipes. Today on I Heart Cooking, we're going to be talking about seafood and more seafood. Mm-hmm. One nice thing about seafood, it's really low in fat. A lot of them has good fats in there, like the omega-3 fatty acids we talked about a couple episodes ago. So that's something that we try to incorporate more of that. American Heart Guidelines kind of shows you, hey, let's eat more fish, at least 3 servings a week if you can, 2 to 3. So these recipes are going to be a great way to incorporate more of that into your diet. And that's actually what we're starting with, is the mock ceviche. So it's very important to realize, and we'll kind of talk about it, why it's called mock and why it's not a true ceviche kind of product there. And Dugan has a great explanation for this.
Absolutely. Most ceviches, you're going to be using something like a scallop or shrimp.
Yep.
That's your 2 main ones. Most the shell fish are good to use, but for this one, we're using tilapia.
Yep.
With tilapia, it's not really recommended to put it in an acid like a normal ceviche would and let it cook that way. So we are going to put it in water, some boiling water, and kind of cook it through till it's completely done, and then add the ingredients for regular ceviche. Regular ceviches is very simple, actually. You just take, let's say you're using shrimp, you put your raw shrimp in a bag or a container, non-reactive container, because you're gonna be doing stuff like lemon juice, lime juice, tomatoes, olives, things that have a lot of acid, a lot of acidity to them. And what you're gonna do is just put it in your refrigerator. Let it sit for, 8 to 24 hours, depending on how much you have. And it's just gonna cook the shrimp for you.
Yep.
Don't have to do anything, you just let it sit in there and it cooks it. Come in 24 hours later and you've got a nice appetizer or something, a nice meal to start eating on, so.
Yeah, I mean, and that's what I think throws a lot of people off, is it's not actually cooked with the heat source.
Mm-hmm.
It's the assets of all the foods that are actually causing that to actually cook through.
Right.
Which is kind of an odd kind of idea
in
a lot of, especially if you're thinking Midwest, you don't really hear a lot of that because you can't do that with any other types of meats.
Right.
I mean, that's something that it's more of, like Dugan said, more of those shell kind of fish that you have.
Mm-hmm.
So because it's mock, we are definitely going to be cooking through that tilapia, and we actually got a pot of water starting to warm up here to boil, and we're going to be cooking that tilapia through.
So what we've done is we've just taken a regular tilapia fillet. We've cubed it up, 1 or 2 inch pieces, however you really like to eat it, that's completely fine. When we've started our water, we just kind of dropped it in there and let it cook through.
Yep.
I'm gonna get rid of our cutting board here that we used. That way we're not cross-contaminating the raw fish with everything else. So now what we're gonna do is combine the rest of our ingredients and just get it ready for the tilapia.
Absolutely.
Very easy to do. We're going to use some sliced jalapenos. You can use whole jalapenos, whatever you have on hand. Got them in your garden. I know that's a perfect thing to grow, and you get a ton of them, so it's one way to save them. We're just going to simply mince it up. Now, I would always recommend using gloves of some kind when you're messing with peppers, especially jalapenos or habaneros, anything with a lot of heat. Because if you don't and you forget about it, you rub your eyes, that is an awful feeling. So always wear gloves. I am not, but I'm gonna go wash my hands as soon as I'm done here. So you'll be safe if you just wear gloves the whole time.
And like Duke said, I mean, this is something you can add as many jalapenos as you want, depending on how hot you like the dish a little bit. Very easy pepper to grow in this area of the country.
Oh, yeah.
And you do get quite a few of them off the peppers there. So that's something that if you want to try to grow these, the perfect opportunity.
Absolutely. So we've minced that up. We're just going to add it to our bowl. Going to add our lemon juice. And I'm going to go wash my hands really quick. So I've washed my hands. I'm ready to start messing with the rest of the ingredients. We've already went ahead. I think I said lemon juice. We're actually using a lime juice. A lot better flavor, a lot less tartness to it. It's very subtle and it's gonna go really well with the fish. So now we're gonna add our herbs. We're using a cilantro and an oregano. So we're just gonna add that in. Just give it a quick whisk. Help spread that around.
One nice thing is we're using dried here, very easily available to have on hand anytime, but you can use the fresh as well.
Absolutely. Using a green pepper, using some diced onions, and another acid we're adding is the tomato. I'm gonna just put a glove on real quick and just kind of toss them to incorporate the lime juice around everything. And you'll notice we've got an avocado here. I haven't added that yet just because after I'm mixing it around is probably a better time to add that, because then it won't break up and get mixed with everything. So just real quick, doesn't take, you know, a ton of stirring, but you're almost making a nice little pico de gallo here. It'd be awesome with a whole grain chip or, you know,
absolutely.
Something nice, refreshing snack to eat on. Okay. Check our fish here. You can see some of them are starting to float. That means that they are starting to get cooked all the way through. Once that's done, we'll drain it out, put it into a bowl. We'll drain it and put it into the bowl that we've got our mixture here in, and we'll just let it cool 20 minutes in the refrigerator and
it should be good to go.
Yeah, absolutely.
So unlike the regular ceviche, like Dugan said, can take up to several hours, 24 hours, for it to be able to cook through. Because it's mocked, we're already doing the cooking here. It's not gonna take long. You're just chilling it is basically the process that we're doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're still gonna get the same flavors. It's just a different cooking method.
Yep.
Instead of cooking with the acid and not really cooking at all, you're gonna boil them on the stovetop and save a ton of time.
Absolutely. Yeah. Especially if you want to eat it within a decent amount of time.
So I'm just going to pull these avocados out here. If you notice what I did, I've done in previous shows, is I just took the knife and I just went into the avocado right down to the seed there, and then I just twisted it real easy all the way around until I made an indentation all the way through, and then I just twisted it off. Now you can take the end of your knife right here, just stab it down in that seed and twist it out. Just like that, it's done, ready to go. So a nice thing about this, what we're making with this avocado, if you know, it gets brown really easy if it's out in the air too much. By adding it to our mixture here, that's an acidity that will prevent it. It's just like apples, it's just like potatoes. If you put something over them, like I know potatoes and water, that prevents them from browning. Apples, you can do lemon juice. You can use something neutral like Sierra Mist.
Yep, absolutely.
That's another option. Just cover it. It'll prevent that oxygen from getting in there and oxidizing everything. So this'll last in the refrigerator, you know, a good 3 or 4 days, even with the avocado in it. I'd start checking it to make sure that you're not browning, but you should be okay.
I say with all the acids that are in there, absolutely.
So we're just gonna slice it real quick, then dice it so it's kind of uniform with everything else that's in there.
That avocado is also gonna give it the different texture compared to some of the other things in there. Mm-hmm. They're gonna have more of that crisp texture. This is gonna have that creaminess in there.
Absolutely. Almost done here. I'm gonna add that right into it. And then the last thing we're gonna do is add a couple olives. I'm not a huge fan of olives, but
neither am I.
It's perfectly fine to be all right with olives. It's another acidity adding to it. We are using a green olive. Kalamata's would be another nice option. They've got a nice sweetness to them. They're not overpowering, and they won't take away from the fish or the rest of the dish here. So
Dugan and I, like we kind of mentioned, we're not big fans of olives, but that's something that we're just going to add a few of them. Again, gets that acidity for that to help with that ceviche kind of feel to it. If you like olives, definitely feel free to add more. Just one advice is know that olives, the way they're kind of made and what the kind of sauce or bread they have in there, it's a lot of sodium. So for 5 olives, you're looking at about 240 milligrams of sodium. Yeah. So you do get a lot of that in there. So if you're kind of watching sodium intake, you might want to watch how much you put in there. But you do have to kind of realize we're not adding any extra salt to this dish either. Mm-hmm. So most of that sodium is coming from the olives.
Yep. Okay, so that's ready. Our fish is are boiling, so we're almost there. We're using tilapia. It's a real thin fish, so it's not going to take very long to cook it off. I'd say we're probably looking at about another minute. We'll go drain it off in the sink and add it to our mock ceviche here.
Yep, and once we add it to that ceviche, we're going to actually cover that, put it in the fridge for about 20 minutes, and then it should be ready to consume. Mm-hmm. So we're adding the tilapia, that last final bit of the dish, and before we put it in the fridge, let it sit there for 20 minutes there, and kind of just gonna stir that all together, and we'll be good to go.
So we just got done preparing our dish, and before we actually go into the tasting of it, we wanted to sit down with your viewers and kind of go through why we came up with the iHeart Cooking program and why we're bringing it to the community. So as many of you know, I'm registered dietitian Jennifer Stachler. And outside of iHeart Cooking, my role here at the Reid Hospital is to actually see patients one-on-one. So I work in the Diabetes and Nutrition Education Department, and I see patients for medical nutrition therapy, which could be anywhere from weight loss to heart health to diabetes related. And I also teach a variety of different diabetes classes, our diabetes self-management classes and our pre-diabetes classes. So I do a lot more besides just the cooking aspect of things.
And my name is Dugan Wetzel. I am the chef here at Reid Health. I am responsible for a lot of the caterings that go outside of here. We do weddings and graduation parties, get-togethers, anything you can think of. We've probably done something similar to it. Also help out with cafeteria food, creating new recipes, improving upon the recipes that we already have, trying to make it a little more healthier, a little more flavorful. Just anything cooking, that's what I do, so yeah.
And I'm Christy Farrell. This is the first time you all have seen me. I've been one of the producers behind the scenes, and my primary role here at Reid Health is clinical nutrition manager. So I work closely with the diabetes nutrition education team and then also the clinical dietitians who see patients in the hospital.
So we had a few questions over the last few seasons about iHeart Cooking and how we actually produced or came up with this project or this cooking show. Question number one being, with the amount of topics and ideas for a healthcare organization to discuss or share with the public, why is this one a worthy project?
Well, I definitely think that we knew we had success with the community cooking class that we hold here at Reid Health. And in working with the Reid Foundation, we had an opportunity to work with and apply for a grant through the American Heart Association. And once we were awarded that grant, we were able to start the production of the first season of iHeart Cooking. You two came up with the cooking all of the recipes for the show. The first season, we really had to use the American Heart Association cookbook and adhere to those guidelines. And I think then spinning off of that for season two, we were able to branch out a little and really come up with, and you guys bounced off of one another, fresh ideas and recipes that we thought would be interesting to the people watching at home.
Absolutely. And that's something that, like Christy said, we kind of used the iHeart Cooking cookbook last year, but this year, this season, we kind of got into more of going on the internet, doing research from blogs and different websites and different ideas just to make it more intriguing and something maybe you've never tried before, which is something we always want to bring to our public and to the community. So that's something we are very excited about this season.
All right, so our next question is, what has been the most enjoyable part of being involved with the program up to this point? I would say for myself, actually, it would be learning new things from you guys, because, you know, I'm meat and potatoes. I'm pretty normal, pretty standard person. But, you know, learning what muesli is, or flax seeds, what's flax seed good for, chia seeds, just all these different grains that, you know, I'm not used to working with, but now I've got some experience with that I can actually tell people. That's what's probably been the most enjoyable for me, at least. So.
I have to say my most enjoyable part is actually being at RPNL, doing the actual cooking of the program, taping it. I mean, we have a lot of fun, a lot of bloopers behind the scenes, just doing things, but it makes it a lot of fun and enjoyable, and just making the meals itself, because I'm somebody, I like to try a new recipe. I don't use the same recipe twice. A lot of times I'm always trying to find something new, so trying different things and doing different things, and also learning from Dugan for the culinary aspect. Like he said, he's learning more of the nutrition. It's kind of vice versa, where I'm learning some tips and culinary skills that definitely my husband's enjoying with that aspect of cooking meats, I know that.
And I think that, you know, just watching the two of you grow from season one to season two and just really refining your skills and your ability to be in front of an audience. And I have to say, probably what I've most gotten out of it is your tips on how to cut various vegetables. Those have been great.
Time savers.
Yes, absolutely. So question number three is there a season three in the works, and what can we expect if so? We, as you all know from season two, had applied for a community benefit grant and received one through Reid Health, and so we'll be doing the same for season three, and we will be letting everyone know if and when that rolls out, so stay tuned.
We have ideas. I mean, it's been brought up. People ask us all the time, oh, can we do like a grilling segment? Can we do something about, you know, more fresh herbs, different things like that? So we'll always incorporate something like that. I know the grilling one's a big one that we've been asked about, so we could possibly see what we can do with that. But a lot of them are just going to be sitting down doing some research and doing some finding of
information
and always asking too.
One of the ideas we've kicked around is to pull in a celebrity within Richmond, so to speak, at each of the segments, which would be a lot of fun, and include them in the actual cooking of the and preparation of the recipes.
What led you to a healthcare, nutrition, or culinary career? For me, what led me into more nutrition is actually when I was 16 years old, I had a meet with a dietitian. Never met a dietitian before, didn't know really what that was about. But because of my own health reasons, I had to. And that really got my involvement into kind of more of healthcare, which I was originally thinking music education, elementary education. So I kind of did a swing during college there. And as I got into more of the nutrition kind of classes at the Ball State University, I got more into where they had to do, you know, run a restaurant. We had to take cooking classes, and it really got me more involved in nutrition and also getting involved into these cooking classes that we do.
Sure. Actually, I was Ball State as well. I actually went for political science. I was actually going to be a lawyer. It was my original career ambition, but graduated from Ball State, started working in a prosecutor's office. I won't name where, but it was pretty stressful, to say the least, and kind of figured I didn't want to do that for the rest of my life, so I wanted to do something that I loved every day, so I did culinary school. So yeah, it kind of went from there, went to culinary school, and then on to the restaurant business, and now here at the hospital. So that's kind of what led me here. So.
Great. And for me, I've always been interested in health and nutrition, and did some internships in high school, and really decided at that point that I was interested in pursuing a career in dietetics. I really enjoy the business aspect of what we do, and so that's what led me into the management aspect of dietetics at this point.
One of the next questions here is, what kind of challenges are there for a chef in a hospital cafe? It is extremely different than a restaurant. You know, they're the same guidelines that you get for all of, like State Board of Health and things like that. But you know, you're dealing with a lot more allergies. You're dealing with, you know, people that are on restricted diets. So you've got to make sure that you've got food that they can eat, but also have food for this other restrictive diet. Plus the people, I mean, as you guys know, you guys work with these patients all the time, so I'm not telling you anything new, but you know, salt, love cooking with salt. That's kind of not an option here most of the time, or butter, things like that. You know, finding new ways to incorporate flavor and the textures that you would normally get at a restaurant from using salt and butter that you can't really use here. So,
oh, absolutely, really, and that's good. Kind of a big thing for, I mean, a dietitian as well, is when we're working with a patient and, you know, maybe they're on a low sodium diet or they're going to have to watch their fat intake or they're trying to lose weight, they still want meals and food to taste good. And so that's something with this program, and also what I do every day, is to encourage people, patients, and actually reassure them that food can still taste good when you make these changes. So that's definitely an obstacle that we deal with day in and day out beyond the iHeart cooking program.
Absolutely. Creating that aha moment for the patient where you're finally getting through to them and helping them to understand that there definitely is a way to be successful.
Sure.
The fifth question is, what would be the number one thing for viewers to take away from the program, in your opinions?
Try new things. And if you don't like it, try it again. Try it made a different way, because I tell individuals all the time, if you don't like something, you're not going to like it after one try. Try it more often. And don't be discouraged with some of these recipes that look like they could be difficult, and they really are not.
Right.
Once you dig it deeper into them, just take the time to kind of prepare ahead of time, plan it out, and it's not as difficult as some of those recipes might look.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, do your research would probably be my thing. If you find a recipe on there that calls for something you've never heard of, you know, look it up. There's so many resources out there that has a ton of information that, it'll, you know, you can look at pictures, you can look at where it's grown, you can look at what it's good in. Just, I mean, these ancient grains are 2,000 years old. These people cooked with this 2,000 years. Yeah. They've kind of perfected what it is and what it's good in. So don't be afraid to do some research, figure out what the product is, and then kind of just, like Jennifer said, be creative and
absolutely
try something different.
One of my favorite parts about the shows is that even if you don't like the recipe being prepared, it's presented in a way where you're still getting nutrition tips, you're still getting technique tips on how to cut vegetables, and so you're still walking away with little tidbits that you can use in your everyday life.
Absolutely. The last question we have, and this is a question that we get a lot of, is can you share a little bit about the community cooking classes offered here at Reid Health?
So the title of our community cooking class is Healthy Cooking with Jennifer and Dugan. First Wednesday of every month.
Yes, first Wednesday of every
5 o'clock. It is free to the public of Richmond. You can come downstairs in the Wingle Hall down here in the basement. And we do exactly like what we do on the iHeart Cooking program, where we prepare the dish, talk about it. The beauty of it is, instead of watching it through the TV, you actually get to eat it. So it's kind of a perk to come to it, is you can try it out and sample everything.
So. Yep, you get to actually try the recipes. You get to, you know, sit there and ask us questions. It's very laid back and very fun. We like to have fun with it.
Yeah.
Beyond what you just see on TV, I would say you see maybe a little bit more behind the scene actions, a little bit. You see, as we're very laid back with it. We like to have fun.
Absolutely.
So.
Participants also walk away with recipes outside of what's just being made, which is nice. And we've really tried to take to look at the community needs, and so we have employee cook well in 30 classes that Jennifer and Dugan also lead once a month for our Reid Health employees, and the idea behind that is to allow them to eat a meal made in 30 minutes or less while they're watching it be prepared. And so really to tack on to the whole notion of, you know, cooking is hard when you have a busy lifestyle. Sure. And then, of course, the community cooking classes, and then iHeart Cooking for people who can't come on site, who can watch it in the comfort of their own homes.
So there were a variety of different questions that we kind of answered about our program and iHeart Cooking. We hope that you continue to watch our program, and hopefully you're finding some enjoyable tips and having fun with the cooking recipes like we're having with them. Like we said, it's a lot of fun. We're enjoying it. So hopefully you'll continue to watch, and we'll get back to our taste testing of our recipe here.
And then we have our ceviche. We're here trying to grasp all of the vegetables on here on my fork. We can, and it's not allowing me. So I want to try it all together in one bite. So the really big flavor I get right away is that lime juice that we're kind of like the acid that's regular ceviche would be cooking that in or cooking through the seafood, but it's very cold, light, refreshing.
Yep.
But great for a summertime dish. I think of the beach, kind of sitting there eating something, you're hot on the beach, but this is nice and cool and refreshing.
Mm-hmm. It's got a nice little heat aspect to it too from the jalapenos that kind of finishes it off at the end.
Absolutely.
Really good.
Thank you for watching iHeart Cooking. We hope you enjoyed all the dishes we prepared today on seafood.
For more heart healthy recipes, you can visit Reid Health's website at reidhealth.org/iHeartCooking.
Thanks for tuning in.